Okay, so recording has started right now. Yeah, so like as you can see, I've cleared out the IPv6 routing altogether, and we are now going to configure the IPSLA. That's what we are going to configure right now. So in that case, if I type do ping, again, if I try to ping google.com, okay, now as you can see, it gives me a proper response because it's able to resolve it, and accordingly, it's able to work. Okay, So based on that, let's now go ahead and configure the IPSLA. To configure the IPSLA, the command line is IPSLA1. Okay, and then I'll type ICMP echo, and then I'm supposed to define the destination name or the IP address. Now, if I put up the name, I'm basically checking up two things: one, connectivity with regards to IP, as well as I'm checking up the name resolution. Okay. But if I just put up the IP address, which means I'm just checking up connectivity, not the name resolution. You know, so in that case, you can decide how you want to do it. So let's say I configure ICMP echo and then google.com, so that every time it'll go ahead and ping google.com. That's what it's going to do. I'm going to keep the frequency as, let's say, every 10 seconds. Okay, meaning every 10 seconds, it's going to go ahead and ping google.com. Okay, so that's the kind of configuration that I did. And then the next thing that I want to do is, after configuring this IP SLA for pinging google.com, I need to define a schedule. Like how long it's supposed to run, when it's supposed to start, all those kind of things is what I need to do. So for that, I need to type IPSLA schedule, and then for the entry number of 1. Now this entry number of 1 corresponds to this command here, which I defined, IPSLA1, this number. Okay, so whatever number you define there, that's what you'll define here. So IPSLA schedule 1, start time, and then I'll define now, and then live forever. Meaning what? It means the IPSLA will start immediately, and then it will continue forever. It will never stop. Understood that part? Okay, so this is how typically you can configure IPSLA. So just to give you the idea for that, I'll type show running config, and then pipe section SLA. So as you can see, this is what I've typed in. IPSLA1, ICMP echo, and it has resolved it to the appropriate IP address. Frequency of 10 seconds. Saying when I IPSLA the config tool that you can go for.
Sir, इसमें कितने SLA configure कर सकते हैं?
When it comes to SLA, I think 255 entries configure.
Okay, so SLA1, SLA2, SLA3 according to
SLA. Like if I type config T, okay, and if I type IP SLA and then question mark. Okay, no, actually 255 is other.
Okay,
214 this number. That's that many number of SLA
entries. Okay.
So about 2 billion. But yeah, matlab itna sara SLA, I mean each of them running different tests. That is the point. Okay. Now going forward, so that is what they have shown out here. Okay. The next tool that we need to understand with regards to troubleshooting is traceroute. Okay, now traceroute, basically what it does is, it gives you the path it takes to reach a particular destination. Like for example, from R2, if I try to type in traceroute and then let's say google.com, it should show me the entire path. Okay, that's what is going to happen. Like if I type traceroute google.com, as you can see, it resolved to 132.217.166.46, and now it should go ahead and give me the appropriate response. But as you notice, everywhere it's showing me a star. Okay, so it's showing me a star everywhere, and along with that, you'll also see list 101 denied ICMP. So bottom line is ICMP is getting blocked. Now, what is the story behind this? Now, remember, whenever you do a ping, you know, regular ping, what happens is in that case, your machine goes ahead and sends out an ICMP echo request or or it's also called as ICMP echo. And then the remote machine gives back a echo reply. But when you do a trace route, the like configuration or the process is a bit different. In the sense, my machine is going to send out an echo, but the remote machines are going to give me two different responses. ICMP unreachable, okay, that's one response that I'm going to get. And the next response that I'm going to get is ICMP time exceeding.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what's happening here. Like as you can see, I'm getting responses from 10.241.1.6 or 10.240.254.1. I'm getting responses from all this IP, but my access list is going ahead and blocking it. And it's blocking ICMP type 11. Now what is ICMP type 11? Like if I go back into Google or on the internet, and if I try to search for ICMP type 11, okay,
mm-hmm.
So type 11, like I told you, is time exceeded. So the time exceeded messages are getting blocked from the internet. So bottom line is, as soon as it reaches a particular router, it will go ahead and give me a ICMP time exceeded, and that's what is giving me a problem. Apart from that, as you notice here, ICMP type 3 is also getting blocked.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now what is ICMP type 3? Like if I type ICMP type 3 and press enter, as you can see, ICMP type 3 is destination unreachable. So remember, there are two messages that gets responded or that is given back to you from the remote device. One is ICMP time exceeded and the other one is ICMP unreachable. But at this point, my access list, which I have configured on router R2, is blocking both of them. And that's the reason the trace route is not working. Everywhere I'm getting a star. So I'll just stop this trace route. The way to stop the trace route is Ctrl-Shift-6. That's what you need to press. Ctrl-Shift-6. Okay? So now, if I type show access list at this point, as you can see, on access list 101, I have only allowed echo reply. I have not allowed any other ICMP. That's the reason the trace route is not working. So what I'm going to do now is, I'll allow the two types of messages, and accordingly you'll see the trace route starts working. So, config key, IP access list, extended, 101, and then I'll type, let's say line number 5, and then permit, ICMP, any, and then time exceeded. That's one message that I'm going to allow. Okay, so that's one message that I allowed. And then the next thing that I'm going to allow is unreachable. But I'll keep it as line number 6. So basically what I did was, if I look back at the access list, as you can see, I've allowed ICMP any time exceeded and ICMP any unreachable. Okay, so along with the echo reply, I've also allowed these two messages. I'll just save it. And now let me do the trace route again. So again, when I try to do a trace route to google.com, this time access list should not block it. And as you can see, I started getting the response. But again, it comes up with a star. Now that's not because of my access list, it may be because they have some sort of firewall or some sort of a blocking device which is blocking the messages out there.
Okay.
But after that, I started getting the response. Got the logic now? Okay, so remember, whenever we talk about connectivity or trace route, you know, there are three different messages involved. I am sending the echo request, and then in return, I'm getting two types of responses. ICMP time exceeded and ICMP unreachable. So since I had an access list, those two were getting blocked, but the moment I allowed them, it started working. Similarly, if I try to do a trace route to any other destination, instead of google.com, let's say I try, facebook.com. So there also, as you can see, it starts working. And the same location, it gives me a star. That confirms that there is some sort of a blocking device in the path. You know, maybe it's a firewall that is deployed by the service provider. That could be the reason, again, we are getting these kind of stats. Okay, but eventually it will take or show me the entire path and it will show me how to reach Facebook.com. Learn that part. But as you can see here now, we are seeing star twice. maybe there are multiple blocking that is happening. Or another reason could be, you know, the facebook.com, it's not giving me responses. Like if I try to ping facebook.com from my network, maybe it does not ping at all. Let me try again. Ping facebook.com. And as you can see, I'm not really getting any replies. Instead, I should see request timeout. And that's the reason why traceroute also gives me a start. So basically for facebook.com, my service provider does not allow ICMP. You understand that? Like until this point it's allowed, but beyond that, it's not allowing the ICMP. And that's the reason I'm seeing request timeout. Make sense now? Okay. So that's how, or that's one of the other tools that you can go for troubleshooting any kind of connectivity, that is traceroute. You can also use a telnet utility. Now when I talk about the telnet utility is typically used for testing TCP based application. What do I mean by TCP based application? Any application that is running on TCP, like for example HTTP. HTTP is a TCP application working on TCP port 80. HTTPS, it works on TCP port 443. Telnet, it is working on TCP port 23. FTP, which works on TCP port 21. So if you want to test a TCP application, that's where you can use the telnet utility. So just to give you that example, what I can literally do is, I can get on into this router, okay, and I can type telnet, any particular destination, like for example, if I type telnet and 192.168.0.5, okay, that's my RDP server, the remote desktop server, and let's say I try to connect to 3389. Now remember, TCP port 3389 is used for remote desktop. So if I want to check whether this particular port or application is running, I just have to press enter after that. And if it shows open, meaning everything is good. And as you can see, it definitely shows open. So if it shows open, meaning that application is running, and we know that because we are connected to the remote desktop. Do you get that? So I just press Control Z or Control C for that matter. Okay, but the problem is since it's remote desktop, I'm not able to exit out of that. So how do I exit in this case? I have to press Control Shift 6 X and then I'll type disconnect. So when I do that, we'll go ahead and close the session. But the point is, when I type this kind of a command, telnet, IP address and the port number, if it shows open, meaning the port is open. Similarly, instead of 3389, let's say I try to connect to 21 and I'll press enter. As you can see, it says trying and then open, meaning I connected to this particular server, FileZilla server, and TCP port 21 is FTP server, and that's exactly what it shows as connected. Okay, in fact, just to show you further, if I type user FTP user, as you can see, it says password required for FTP user. And if I type pass and the password, as you can see, it shows logged out. Understood that part? Okay, and if I type list, it gave me an error. But if I type list and forward slash, it says bad sequence of commands. Now, for that, I need to know the appropriate FTP command supported on this FTP server. But then the point is, I'm connected to this port number 21. So I know this particular service is running. Understood that part? So any service related to TCP, if you want to test, this is the way you can go about doing it. You tell it and connect to that particular port number. Okay. So I'll just press Control C and enter. Okay. But still, it's saying command that undocumented. I'll type quit and I should be able to exit out of that. Similarly, if I type telnet google.com and then 443, I'm connecting to HTTPS. And when I press enter, there you go. It says open, meaning HTTPS is accessible on google.com. Mm-hmm. And if I press Control Z and enter, okay, there you go. It immediately closes the connection. Understood part? So any TCP connectivity, if you want to check, this is the way you can do that. Similarly, if you remember, in one of my previous sessions, I had also talked about one more command, which when you run, it will tell you what ports are open on the local machine. Like for example, on router R2, if I want to check what ports are open, there is a command show control plane, okay, and then host, and then open ports. When I do that and press enter, as you can see, it clearly shows 22 is open, 23 is open, 22 is SSH, 23 is telnet, 80 is HTTP, 443 is SSL or HTTPS. UDP 67 is also enabled, that is DHCP, okay, and then HSRP is also running, that is UDP port 1985. So bottom line is, all the services that are running on the local device can be known using this particular command, show control plane, post, open port. That's the kind of command that you can go for. And this is the part. So that's the telnet utility. Remember, telnet is only for TCP connections, you cannot test it for UDP. Okay, show ARP is another command which, like, I basically did that today, like right at the start. You know, so basically, this is a command by which you can check whether you are able to get hold of the MAC address or the remote device. If you are not able to get the MAC address of the remote device, maybe that device is offline. You know, that could be the possibility for it, or the cable is disconnected. It could be any of the reasons for it. Okay. On the switch, you can go in for show MAC address table. That will show you the layer 2 table. You know, that is maintained by the switch, wherein it shows you the port number, the VLAN, and then the corresponding MAC address that it has learned. Okay, so that was that section talking about the troubleshooting part. The next thing is about physical connectivity. So earlier we talked about end-to-end connectivity, checking whether that is operational. Now we'll check how to check on the physical connectivity. So for the physical connectivity, that's the commands that you can go for, like show interface, interface ID. That will show you about the input queue, input errors, output errors. So if at all you find a lot of errors, or if you do not find any traffic coming in or going out, you know that is something to do with the cable, or you are not physically connected to the network. That could be one of the commands that you can go for. You can also check on the duplex configuration. Like if you remember, earlier we had talked about the speed mismatch, duplex mismatch and so on, right? So you have to make sure that the speed and duplex is matching at both ends. So typically when the link is configured for auto negotiation, this is one of the things that we need to cross check. If you want to check whether the traffic is taking the correct path, for that you need to look at the routing table. Okay, whether you configure static routing or dynamic routing, you have to make sure that it takes the correct path, and that you will find it out by looking at show IP route. Now in this example, as you can see, when you type show IP route, it's only showing you the directly connected and the local route. There is no static route, there is no default route, nothing of the sort. So bottom line is, branch router should not be able to connect to the server at all. Are you getting me now? So that is one of the things that you can typically find out, like just by looking at the routing table, because it does not have an entry towards 172.16.1.100. So that is one of the things that you can find out. Now these are all the different types of entries that you'll find in the routing table. You have the directly connected route, local host routes. Now the difference between directly connected and local host route is, directly connected will show you the network that is attached to the router interface, or that is configured on the router interface. Local host route will show you the local IP address that is configured on the router interface. So directly connected will show you the network that is attached, or the network that is configured, and local host will show you the IP address that is configured on the interface. And then apart from that, you have the default route, static routing, and the dynamic routing, if at all you are running some dynamic routing protocols. SPAN is another option that you can go for. Now the concept of SPAN is, you can make use of SPAN to watch over or monitor or capture traffic from a switch environment. Now practically, like when we talked about the operation of the switch, a switch by default only forwards frames from one port to the other. That's the default behavior of a switch, right? Like for example, if PC1 is communicating with PC2, it's only going to forward the frame from Ethernet 0/1 to Ethernet 0/2. But on the switch, if you configure SPAN, that is switch port analyzer network, in that case, it will make sure that apart from forwarding the frame from Ethernet 0/1 to Ethernet 0/2, it will duplicate that frame, and that duplicate frame will also be sent out to this particular interface, depending upon what is the source and what is the destination. remember, whenever you configure a span on a switch, you are supposed to configure the source and the destination. So the source is defining where the traffic or which traffic you want to capture, and destination is defining where you want to send that duplicate frame. So in this example, the destination would be Ethernet 0/3, and on this Ethernet 0/3, there is a computer connected with Wireshark running on. Okay, so that's the kind of a thing that you can typically do out here. So advantage of that is you can literally capture or monitor all the traffic that is passing across on your network. Understood the logic term? Clear? Okay. So to understand this further, what I'm going to do right now is I'll get back into the topology diagram and I'll show you the configuration of span. So to do that, now that's my topology diagram, and if you remember, like when I talk about the VPC, okay, the virtual PC, this virtual PC is running on 192.168.1.0, that's VLAN 2.
Mm-hmm.
And if I talk about this virtual PC, it's running on 192.168.10.0. Okay, mm-hmm. Like just to verify that, I'll just open up the virtual PC and I'll type show IP. And at this point, it's saying it can't find the DHCP server. Let me check on that again. I'll type IP DHCP again. Now, of course, this could be something to do with the connectivity and all of that. But at this point, it got an IP. And as you can see, it got an IP of 192.168.10.251.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's good. I mean, this is working on VLAN 10. But at the same point of time, what I'm going to do next is, I'll get on into this VPC. And here, if I type IP DHCP again, so here it got an IP of 192.168.1. So bottom line is, it is confirmed that this virtual PC belongs to VLAN 2 and this virtual PC belongs to VLAN 25. Okay, that is what we have. But now what I want to do is, like let's say I go into this router 1, and on router 1, okay, if I type in, let's say, show IP interface brief. As you can see, I have two different sub-interfaces that I've configured, one for VLAN 2 and the other one for VLAN 25. Okay, so based on this, okay, I need to configure span. Now for configuring span, for our example, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to put up, let's say, so I'll go ahead and put up a Windows machine here, a Windows machine into this topology, which will be running Wireshark. And through that, I'll be able to capture traffic. But for doing that Wireshark, I'll configure one of these switches with span. That's what I'm going to configure out. Make sense?
Mm.
Okay, so that's what I'm going to do out here. Now to do that, what I'll do is, now router R1 is connected via VLAN 1. So basically what I'm going to do now is, on this switch 6, I'll connect that Windows machine. I'll configure it for VLAN 1 so that it belongs to this particular network, 192.168.2.0. Okay, I'll give it a static IP, and then accordingly, I'll go ahead and do the necessary configuration of span on this particular switch. So bottom line is, you know, let's say for this example, I'll just power off this particular switch here. I'll unlock the lab, add an object, node, and from the list, I'm going to choose Windows. And I'll just scroll down. Okay, so that's what I'm going to use here. I'll click on save. So there you go, that's my Windows machine. But more importantly, I'll drag and drop this connectivity to this particular switch. And as you can see, it's connected on Ethernet 1/1 of the switch. That's what is happening. So I'll just save it. So my Windows machine is connected. But now, more importantly, let me now go ahead and power it on. So start. And start this also. Now, while that is happening, okay, I'll get on into the switch and I'll make sure that I configured Ethernet 1/1 to belong to VLAN 1. Okay, that's how I'm going to configure, so that this machine will be part of VLAN 2. Oh, sorry, VLAN 1. Okay. So I hope you understood the concept here. Basically, what I want to do is I'll be connecting to an FTP server from router R1, or like from this virtual PC, I'll try to send some traffic across to the internet, and all that traffic will be able to capture it on this particular Windows machine. That's what we want to do. But practically, that would have not occurred, right? If at all we do not configure span on these switches, what will happen is practically it won't happen because it is port-to-port communication. But just because I will configure span where destination would be this Windows port, so automatically everything will be captured in the wireshark. That's what is going to happen out here. Make sense? Okay. So I'll just wait for this Windows machine to come up. Now while that is happening, I'll get on into the switch and I'll configure the necessary VLAN config. So I'll get on into switch 6 for that. So what I'll do is, meanwhile, while this machine is coming up, I'll make sure that I configure span and I'll show you the VLAN port configuration and all of that. Okay? So Ethernet 1/1, that's what I want to configure. So I'll get on into switch 6. And on switch 6, if I type show VLAN bridge, so as you can see, Ethernet 1/1 belongs to VLAN 1, but it's a dynamic port. I want to configure it as a static access port. That's what I want to do. So that's why I'll type config T, interface E1/1, and then I'll type switch port mode access, and that's about it. That should typically do it. And along with that, I'll also put in switchboard no negotiate, so that it does not negotiate what's the status, or it does not negotiate any kind of, okay, that's a Windows machine, but yeah. So it does not negotiate whether it's going to be trunk or access or nothing. It will be a static access port. That's what I configured out here. Now, once I've done that, okay, if I type show interface E1/1, you'll notice it shows Ethernet 1/1 is up, line protocol is up, and it shows that it is connected. Clear that part? But now what I want to do is, I want to generate or copy traffic associated with VLAN 2 and pick it up and send it across to this particular port. That's what I want to do. Okay, so that's why what I'm going to do is configure terminal. That configuration you can do it using span. So to configure span, the command line is monitor session, okay, and then you need to define a session ID. So let's say the session ID is 1 for this example, and then I'm supposed to define a source. Now when it comes to source can be either a particular interface, or it could be remote meaning from another switch, or it could be a particular VLAN. So in our case, we want to monitor VLAN 1 related traffic. Okay, so we want to capture traffic associated with VLAN 1. So that's why I type monitor session 1, source VLAN 1, and then we are supposed to define what kind of traffic do you want to capture. Do you want to capture both transmitted and received traffic, or do you want to just capture received traffic or transmitted traffic? So that is what you can select out here, but I'm going to type both, meaning what? Both received as well as transmitted traffic is what I want to capture out here. And then I'll type monitor session, the same session ID, and then I'll type destination interface E1/1. That's what I'm going to define. Okay, that says public network, so I think it got hold of the IP address also, and because of that, it should be able to communicate on the internet also. Let me cross check that. I'll just open up the command prompt, IP config. Yes, it definitely got 192.168.2.251. So definitely it should be able to connect and communicate on the internet. But before we go on into that, if I go back into the switch right now, some odd reason my switch interface got closed. Oh, okay, my switch got powered off. I don't know why. So let me start it off again. Okay, so I don't know what happened there, but okay, it's on again. So let me type show monitor session and then one. When I do that, okay, it says no span configuration is present. So basically what happened was whatever configuration I did, I lost it. Okay, that's what has happened. So let me go ahead and reconfigure it. So config T. Okay, also do show run interface E1/1. So okay, at least that configuration is saved, but the span configuration is not saved. So let me type monitor session 1 source VLAN 1, let's say port, and then monitor session 1 destination interface E1/1. That's what I'll do. Okay, I think what's happening is for some odd reason the span configuration is crashing this particular switch. Okay, that is the issue out here. Okay, the span configuration is crashing the switch and that's the reason it's not working out. Clear for that? So I guess it will be a problem to show you this particular lab. But yeah, I can definitely do that by going ahead and replacing the switch with another image. I think right now what I'm using is, like if I unlock the lab, if I right click on the switch and if I click edit, right now I'm using Cisco IOL image, but if you want to really see a span configuration, you need to have a VIOS L2, okay, a virtual IOS L2 switch. If you make this up, you'll be able to see the spanning configuration. So that's why what I'll do is, I'll just power off this lab and I'll show you this particular lab in another kind of topology that I have. Okay, only for this lab. I mean, for some reason the span configuration is not supported, I think, on this image, and that's the reason it's giving me an error. So I'll just stop this topology and I'll power on the other topology that I have. Okay, so only for this particular lab, I'll do it that way, okay? So I'll just close the lab. And I'll go into CCNA and I'll open up CCNA 10.6. Now this is a topology that I'm using in another training of mine. Okay, so I'll use that topology and accordingly explain that to you. Okay. So as you can see in this topology, we have all of these machines as virtual PC, but DC is Windows machine. So this Windows machine is going to capture traffic. So bottom line is, on switch 2, I might have configured span. Let me go ahead and cross check that. So I'll just power on the lab. Now remember, the router and switch that I'm utilizing in this topology is VIOS. Okay, that is virtual IOS. That's what I'm utilizing out here. So I'll get on into switch 2. So let it boot up, and while that is happening, I'll also open up the Windows machine. Okay, so that's the difference. Like the one that we had in our topology was Cisco IOL, that is IOS over Linux, but this version of the image that I'm utilizing is virtual IOS or VIOS. So I think I might have already configured span in this topology, so that's why I'll first show you the configuration that I've done and then I'll accordingly show you that Wireshark is able to capture the traffic. Okay, so I'm just waiting for it to boot up completely. There you go. So the Windows machine is also up and running. Just waiting to get an upgrade hold of an IP address here. Okay, so that's the only problem with this particular image. It takes a little while to boot up as compared to the other switch. Okay, but at least it supports that particular feature, so that's why I'm utilizing this switch. Okay, so as you can see, I've configured the switch. I mean, I've powered up or booted up the switch too. And now if I type show run pipe include and monitor, that's what I'm going to search for. And as you can see, it's already configured with monitor session 1 and the source VLAN is 20. It does not show both or RX or TX or nothing. That's because by default the configuration is for both. So that's why both is hidden. Okay, that's what is happening out here. So it's going to capture both received traffic as well as transmitted traffic. And then it's going to send it outside destination interface of gigabit 0/1. That's the interface it's going to send it out on. So if I go back into the topology diagram, gigabit 0/1 is connected to the Windows version. So the source is going to be VLAN 20. Now VLAN 20 is where this particular switch is also configured on. So from the switch, if I send out any traffic on VLAN 20, I'll be able to pick it up on this wireshark. That's the logic behind this particular config. Now since I configured this as a destination interface, gigabit 0/1 is a destination interface, if I go back into the console and if I type show interface, you know, normally when I type show interface and the interface ID, it shows up and up, right? But just because I configured span and gigabit 0/1 is the destination interface, it shows gigabit ethernet 0/1 is up. Line protocol will be shown as down, but more importantly, it will show monitoring. Monitoring meaning it can capture traffic, it can listen to traffic. And that is one indication of you understanding that it's configured with span. You have that part? Okay. But at the same point of time, you also have another command, show monitor session, and then you can type 1. So when you do that, as you can see, it shows source VLAN 20 and it's capturing both traffic, that is transmitted and received traffic, and destination port is configured as gigabit 0/1. Make sense? Okay, so since I've done this, now if I go back into my Windows machine, okay, I think I have configured or installed Wireshark on this. So let me open up Wireshark. Yeah, there you go. Wireshark is already installed. So I'll just open that up. So remember, by default, it will not pick up any traffic. It will only pick up traffic if at all there is some traffic received on VLAN 20. By default, at this point, it will pick up traffic that is being originated from this Windows machine itself. Or else, if this Windows machine is receiving any traffic from anywhere else, that is the traffic it will show. Okay. So there you go. Wireshark loaded up. I'll have to just give it a bit of time. As you can see, it shows local area correction and it shows me as kind of a graph here indicating that it has already started capturing traffic. So I'll just double click on it and it'll show me the traffic that it has captured. So it's not showing me any traffic here for some odd reason. Okay, maybe there's no traffic or nothing coming up here. But let's wait for a while and then we should have something. There you go. It came up with browser. Local master announcement. Okay. So bottom line is, it has started sending out some info, and as you can see, it's showing ICMP version 6 right now.
Mm-hmm.
That's because this machine might be configured with IPv6, and it's sending out a neighbor solicitation message. Like if you remember, when we talked about ICMP or ICMP version 6, neighbor solicitation is one message that it sends, and that's what you can see out here. Clear with that?
Yes, sir.
So it's definitely working in that fashion. But based on that, now let's try to send some traffic on VLAN 20. So for that, what I'll do is I'll get on into switch 2, and if I type show IP interface brief, like this switch has an IP address configured on VLAN 20 interface. So naturally, it belongs to VLAN 20, right? Whatever traffic it will send, it will be on VLAN 20. So that's why what I'm going to do is I'll type telnet, okay? 192.168.0.5 and then 21, meaning I'm trying to send some FTP traffic. So that FTP traffic should be captured and seen on this wiretap. That's what I want to demonstrate to you.
Okay.
So I'll just press enter. And there you go. It's connected. But more importantly, while it's connected, if I go back into my Wireshark, as you can see, there is some TCP traffic that has been captured. And as you can see, FTP is also shown. Do you see that? So if you look at the flow of communication, like I'll take you back into the topology diagram, what I did was I initiated an FTP traffic from this switch, going via switch 1 into this router, and through that going onto the internet, because my FTP server is beyond this particular cloud.
Okay.
But even though it went in this direction, I got that traffic on this particular machine because I configured SPAN on this particular switch.
Okay.
So remember, practically, whenever you want to do network monitoring, SPAN is what you need to typically configure. Clear on that part? Okay,
yes.
So I can see that, there is someone who is connected via FTP, but let's say I type user and FTP user. I'll try to send some traffic through it, okay? So pass and password. Oops. That says login time exceeded because I kept it connected for quite some time without sending up any information. So again, let me try again. So user, FTP user, password. So I'm correct. Okay, it came up with an error. So user, FTP user, password. It says logged on. Okay, and now, not hello. It will be, let's say, help. Okay, now these are all the commands that are available out here. So let's say I type now we have all of this option here. Let me type CWD. So bottom line is I'm running certain kind of thing, but as you can see, it says slash is the current directory, meaning it's showing that it's root. And I'll type quit. So bottom line is I connected to the FTP and all of that. So let's see whether my Wireshark picked up all of this. And as you can see, it has definitely picked up all of that. And it also shows me the messages that I saw on the command prompt. So let me go ahead and monitor this traffic. So to do that, I'll go back right to the start, of all the FTP. In fact, what I'll do is, I'll just type in the filter section, I'll type TCP. That's what I'm going to do. And I'll press enter. So there you go. Immediately it shows me all the TCP traffic. I'll right click on the first frame out here. I'll go into follow, and under follow, I'll click on TCP stream so that it gives me a summary of the entire communication that occurred. And the best part is, it shows me exactly what I did earlier. Like this is for the first time. First time when I connected, by the time I started typing the password, it showed me login time exceeded and it closed the connection. But this was the first time. But now let me get on into the next time when I connected. So for that, I'll just right click. I'll have to scroll down. It showed login time exceeded out here and it closed the connection. So let me start from here again. Okay, I'll start from here so that this is a fresh connection that I use. So follow and TCP stream. And as you can see, this is still showing. I find next? If at all I get some other info, no. So let me scroll down further. Okay, now that's the only information that is showing. It's not showing me the entire thing. So what I'll do is I'll just clear out this filter. Okay. And then what I'll do is, I'll start from here because this is the new session that I use. So I'll right click, follow, and into the stream. And now this time I can see, whatever password I typed, it's exactly showing me everything, the username that I typed, what commands I executed. That's because FTP is a clear text protocol. So it clearly shows me whatever traffic I sent. Got the point now? So bottom line is, Wireshark was able to pick up everything.
Okay,
and SPAN works in this particular fashion. Everybody clear on this?
Yeah.
So this was for FTP. Similarly, any traffic has to end on VLAN 20, Wireshark will be able to capture. Okay, so that is the concept of SPAN. So what it really does is, whatever frame we have defined under the source, it will duplicate that frame and send it across to the destination port. That's the logic of SPAN. Okay, so that's the command line for it, which I already showed to you. Okay. But you can also check whether the default gateway is correct. So for that, again, show IP route is the command that you can go for. On the switch, you can go in for show IP route. That will show you the IP default gateway command that has been configured. But on a Windows machine, if you want to check the routing table, that's the command you can go for, route print. Or you can type ipconfig. When you type ipconfig, there also you will get the default gateway. There also you can find out whether it has been configured right. You can also check the name resolution entry, whether it is correct. So for that, you have to just ping using the name. That's the best way to do that. Okay, like in here, they have been configured with the IP address of 1.16.1.100 and it has been mapped to server.
Mm-hmm.
So when they type ping server, naturally it is working properly because name resolution is right. But then you have to try using the ping command, and instead of IP address, you have to put the name so that you can check whether communication is good.
Mm-hmm.
Now here they are showing you how to configure and verify access list. Now we have talked about this enough when we talked about access list, but just to give you a quick revision or recap, when you're configuring extended access list, you can define the port number, protocol, source address, and destination along with the permit or deny action on it. So in that case, okay, there you go. I mean, here they're showing you how to configure the access list and how to apply it, but more importantly, okay, there you go. That's the command line for it. But more importantly, when it comes to verifying the access list, that's the command. Show IP access list, you can put the name, or you can just type the IP access list. We'll show you all the access lists that are configured on that particular device. Okay, now here what they're seeing is they are configuring an NTP client, but it shows clock is unsynchronized. That may be because the access list is not allowing it, because NTP works on UDP port 123. And as you can see, it clearly says deny UDP any NTP. So naturally it is being denied. And that's the reason NTP is not going to work in this scenario. Okay. They are trying telnet, and there it shows open because telnet was allowed. Okay, so any traffic you want, this is how you can check it. Like here, you're trying to send SSH traffic, but it says destination unreachable, maybe because the access list is blocking it. So show IP access list or show access list will allow you to verify whether the traffic is allowed or denied. Ping, that's for ICMP. Okay. So accordingly, whatever traffic is allowed or denied, you can see the hit count, and accordingly you can make out whether the traffic is being allowed or denied or blocked. Okay. So that was that section for access list. Okay. So that's the final thing. I mean, you have to check whether an access list is blocking the traffic. Okay. So that's the command line for it. Show IP access list. Okay. So when it comes to troubleshooting, those are all the tools that you can make use of. So it's just a summary of everything that we talked about. Okay, so I'm not going to spend time talking about that again. But I hope you are clear with every tool that I demonstrated in this particular section. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
quickly go ahead. Okay, so that was that section there. Okay. Now, when it comes to IPv6, same steps or same procedures would be followed, but you know, when it comes to access list or IPv6, these are certain things that you have to be first clear on. You need to know that there are global addresses, unique local addresses, linked local addresses, reserved, loopback, and unspecified. Now, we discussed about all of this when we did IPv6. Okay, I think Neeraj was also there in that session.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so during that time, we have gone over all of this, but it's just a quick revision of all of that. Okay. That's the prefix info and all of that with regards to all of these addresses. So I'm not going to spend time talking about that. I'll quickly jump over to the the assignment of the address and so on. Like here, as you can see, they are assigning an address in this fashion. But if you want to use the EUI64, that's what you can do. You can define the prefix info and then EUI64. So it will automatically calculate that. You can also go in for stateless autoconfig, or you can go in for stateful using ESP. Okay. Now that's the EUI64 interface ID calculation that we discussed when we did IPv6. But now, as you could see, the steps for troubleshooting IPv6 and IPv6 has not changed at all. So I'm not going to spend the same amount of time like IPv4. So I'll just quickly go ahead. That's the ping command that they're demonstrating here. Tracert command, that's on a Windows system, but on a Cisco device, it will be traceroute. That's what you need to go. Okay. Telnet is another option you can go for. The netsh command to show the IPv6 neighbors. Okay, on a Windows system, that's the command you can go for. Netsh interface IPv6 show neighbor. But on a router, if you want to see the IPv6 neighbor, that's the command, show IPv6 neighbor. Okay, so basically, you have to check whether IPv6 routing is enabled, whether the interfaces have IPv6 address configured, and then if at all there are some routing protocols that are configured for IPv6. These are the things that you need to go ahead and cross-check.
Okay,
so that's what they're doing using the show IPv6 route command. IPconfig, that will also show you the IPv6 address and the link local address. Okay. That's the name resolution that they're checking out here. Now, when it comes to access list for IPv6, the only change when it comes to configuring access list for IPv6 is there is no concept of standard or extended in IPv6. In the case of IPv6, there is only one access list that you configure, that's a named access list.
Okay,
so whatever you give, like number or name, it is treated as a name itself. Okay, so just to give you the syntax for it, as you can see, that's the syntax for it. IPv6 access list, and you have to give it a name. And under that, the same logic that like what we learned for IPv4, and then for applying it, the command line is you have to go to the interface and type IPv6 traffic filter, and then this particular name, and then in or out. That's the change about it, okay? So here we do not have a logic of extended or standard. You just give a name to the access list, define permit or deny just like IPv4, and for applying it, you have to go to the interface IPv6 traffic filter, and then the same name in or out. That's what you need to define.
Okay,
so that's the example for it. As you can see, IPv6 access list example 6, deny UDP NENE or permit TCP host, the IPv6 address NEEQ23. So as you could see, instead of using IPv4 addresses, you're using IPv6. That's the only difference.
Okay.
But when it comes to applying, the command line is IPv6 traffic filter. That's the command line. IPv6 traffic filter, the name of the access list, and then in or out. Okay, depending upon how you want to apply. So that's the change between IPv6 and IPv4. That's the command line to verify the access list that has been configured. Okay, so here they are defining NTP service, but if you remember the access list, it was clearly saying deny UDP and NTP. So naturally, NTP would be blocked. Okay. And that's why it shows clock is unsynchronized.
Okay.
But when they try to telnet, it didn't work because telnet was allowed. SSH is not was not allowed in that access list, but ping or ICMP is allowed.
Okay.
So that was typically that particular section, okay, and I think that should be this particular topic. So yeah, I think that's what it is. It's just a repetition of whatever we went over. So I'll not spend time on that. Yes, I think that's what it is. Okay, so I'll just quickly go forward. Okay, yeah, so that was this topic here. So basically at this point, we have completed with troubleshooting IPv4 and IPv6 connectivity. Okay, but then the next topic that we need to start over, that's where we'll be talking about network device security.
Okay.
So we are going to go over and talk about iOS security features that are available on a router as well as on a switch. Okay, but that we'll be doing in our next session.